Hey, today we're going on a journey to Ephesus. Route 66 comes out of Chicago and goes to Ephesus. Amazing, y'all didn't know that, did you? I did find out that there is a Patmos, Arkansas that has mines in it, so you never know where we're headed on this one. So anyway, Route 66, turn to Revelation. There's only one of them. Chapter 2, we're going to begin with verse 1 and read verses 1 through 7. Verse 1, to the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands, says this, I know your deeds, your toil, your perseverance, and that you cannot tolerate evil men. And you put them to test, all who claim to be apostles, and they are not, and you have found them out to be false. Verse 3, but you have perseverance, and you have endured for the sake of Jesus Christ, for my sake, he says, and you have not grown weary. Verse 4, but I have this against you. You have left your first love. I want you to just let that sink in for a second. I have this against you. You have left your first love. Therefore, remember from where you have fallen and repent and do the deeds that you did at first, or else I am coming to you and I will remove your lampstand out of its place unless you repent. Yet this you do have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will grant be able to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. So in the grand scheme of things, the church of Ephesus is doing pretty well. There are seven things if you count all the way through there and go to verse 6 and find one more, because they hate the Nicolaitans. And well done, Jesus said, because I don't like them either. Man, Jesus just points them out and says, not my kind of people. Well, we're going to not only journey to Ephesus, but we're going to look at it and try to figure out a few of the things that the Lord is telling to that church, that here, I've got these things that are good about you. These things are good. Y'all are doing well, but, and we'll get to verse 4 in just a minute. Have you ever heard of a secret shopper? Okay, there's somebody that is hired to go into a store and shop, and then they give a report back to the manager or the store owner or whoever has hired them to tell them about their store, how it looks, whether things are easy to find on the shelf, whether the signage is good, can they find where they need to go? If they're looking for the restroom, can they find it? If you're in Walmart, it's always somewhere in an odd place, and you have to go through the rest of the store to find it, right? Part of their marketing is, we're going to move stuff around so that the thing you bought last week is not where it used to be. So you have to go look for it. And in the process, we hope you find something new to buy. Impulse buying. Well, that's what secret shoppers do. They go into stores. Companies hire them to look. There are big churches around who are hiring secret shoppers to come into their churches. They'd stand out like a sore thumb with us. We know that somebody was new and they couldn't get away with anything. But if you're in a big church, with hundreds of people or even thousands of people, you can come in and you can check out how the people in the parking lot greet you, or how the ushers in the church help you find your way, or look at the signage, or talk to other people there and just see if they're a friendly church or not. And then you give the report card back to the pastor or whoever hired you. There are churches that do this on a regular basis just to see how they're doing. The church in Ephesus is getting a report card on how they're doing. The Lord Jesus Christ himself is the secret shopper, and he's the one saying to them, you're doing great with a few things. These things, you're doing great. Your doctrine is wonderful. You've got things figured out. You know who you are, what you believe, and you're holding each other accountable. And when people who come in with wrong theology or false ideas, you can sort them out. As we would say, you could ferret them out, and you know who they are, and you call them on it, and you say, look, that attitude is not the same attitude that Jesus has. And then you invite them to go to another place. Or repent and change your ways. Isn't that the right way to do it? All right, now, a few weeks ago when we were still ending the book of John, and I told you we were going to go on this journey, but we needed to sneak and squeeze James in between the two, I told you a couple of things. One of the things I told you is that y'all need to be praying for me. We're in week, what, 3 or 4 of this ordeal so far? And this week I was attacked. I mean, attacked. Now, I'm not blaming you, but I'm asking you that every day when you think of me, I will repent whatever I need to do. But please just say a prayer for me. If my name comes to your head and or in your heart, bow your heart and pray for me. Just a quick sentence prayer. God protect Don today. God be what Don needs today. God, I lift Don up to you today. That's all I need. But if you all are doing that, and I know my wife is doing that, and I know that I do that, probably not as much as I should. But, you know, I just need you all to be praying. Why? Well, verse 4. I don't want that to happen to me or to us. I don't want dissension, division to happen in our church. I don't want us to lose our first love. Amen. Out of all of these things that they did and did well, they persevered. They labored hard. The Greek here is a very specific language, and it's saying, not only did you work and toil, but you did it constantly and without, if you will, grumbling or moaning. You did it because of the love and devotion that you had, but you're doing all of these great things, these wonderful works, and toiling and labor and persevering in it. The people in Ephesus were really good with their works and their doctrine. And yet, when we get through verses 2 and 3, we get to verse 4, and we discover that Jesus has this one thing against them, and it's the worst. I asked in Bible study this morning, has your spouse ever come up to you and ask you the question, or said to you, I feel like we're roommates? You know what a roommate is? Somebody that shares the bills. Right? That's not a good thing. Is your marriage lost all of your love that you had? Remember when you were dating? Heck, I had to ask my wife 12 times to marry me. That's how devoted I am to this crazy thing. She hadn't asked me yet. You know, she's, well, maybe. No, not yet. Man. Finally, on number 12, I'm so tired of you asking me. If you'll just quit asking me, I'll say yes. Just say yes. And oh, by the way, that's almost 43 years. That'll be 43 years next month. So she's a good roommate. Better than the other 4 I had in college, I'll tell you that. So anyway. But have you forgotten your first love? Are you going through the motions? Are you doing the works of church? I also said that I had found a bumper sticker back in the 70s or maybe early 80s, somewhere in there, that just said, Jesus is coming. Look busy. Do you know churches like that? It just seems like they are busy. I heard a pastor of a Baptist church not too long ago claiming that, you know, it's okay to be busy because we're doing the right things. We're serving the Lord by doing this and doing that, and we're helping children, we're helping families, and all of these things are good. But he never circled back to the other appropriate right reason, because we love the Lord. I want to help. Jesus said, true ministry, love, and devotion is this, that you care for widows and orphans. Well, we've got some of those, and we need to be caring for those, right? That's true ministry, love and devotion. But are we doing it out of duty, or are we doing it out of love? There's a big difference. Galatians chapter 5 has the 9 fruit of the Spirit listed. And you know what the first one is? Oh, it's love. Yeah, it's not long-suffering, is it? No, it's love. What did Jesus tell his disciples? They'll know you're my disciples, not because you've learned a lot of great things from me. They'll know you're my disciples if you have love for one another. That should be the hallmark of the Christian church, that we love one another. And verse 4 clearly says to the people in Ephesus, oh, you're doing so many great things, but I have this one thing against you. You have forsaken your first love. And then verse 5, remember the height of where you were and how far you have fallen. You used to love me so much. Your love was, remember the song? Maybe some of you learned it as a child, Deep and Wide, right? Deep and Wide. Your love for God is deep and it's wide. It comes from Ephesians chapter 4. How deep, how wide, how exhaustive is our love or understanding of you? Because in the fourth dimension, it's the fullness of Jesus that completes us. It's the fullness of Christ where we learn how to love each other and be devoted to one another because we're devoted to Him first. Our love and devotion to God supersedes everything else. Now, here's a fun thing about Ephesus. Not only was it a trade center and a route of commerce throughout that part of the Roman Empire, it was called the Queen of Asia. Asia was the designation that Rome had made for that province. Alexander the Great conquered it years before and then handed it off to his 4 generals when he died. It went with Lysimachus, or however you say his name. And then later Rome comes in and conquers the world and conquers that part of what we call modern-day Turkey as well. They called it the province of Asia. Ephesus got the name the Queen of Asia, the province, because it was a beautiful city, it was a trade and commerce route, and it was a port city. They had one of the best ports for shipping and anybody around in that part of the world. They're right on the ocean, the Aegean Sea on the eastern side of Greece and what is the western side of modern-day Turkey. Guess what? Now, if you go to Ephesus, from the city center of ancient Ephesus, where the town was back in John's day, to the Aegean Sea is a 6-mile trek. The Romans came in and helped to beautify the town. They cut down all the trees, or most of them, and they hadn't learned about soil erosion. They didn't call their county agent and ask him if that was a good thing or not. And so when they cut down the trees, guess what? The soil started to erode. And soon, over the process of years, the soil came into the port. And silt and mud and then reeds started to grow. And now it's just a marshy wetland that a boat can't even get near. And land has grown on in and around it. And now it's a 6-mile trek to the water from Ephesus. And if you go into modern Ephesus today, guess what? It is ancient ruins. There's no thriving metropolitan area. It's not a thriving, bustling city. It is a tourist destination for Christians who want to come to see ancient Ephesus. At one time, it sported an arena that would hold 25,000 people. Now, it was, yes, an outdoor arena, but it was 4 times bigger than the Parthenon in Athens. 4 times. It was a massive structure made out of stone. 25 people could gather and nestled in a crook of a hill, and so they could do dramas and play acting and political speaking and whatever else from this thing and be the entertainment of the capital, entertainment capital of that area. And verse 5 says, remember how far you have fallen? He's not talking about Ephesus, the city, and how great it is and how beautiful it is. He's talking about the church. You were here. You loved me so much. Your devotion to God was amazing, staggering even. And now, your doctrine's great. You're doing a good thing with your doctrine. But where's your love for me? Because doctrine, even if it's right and sound doctrine like theirs was, even with good doctrine, if the love of Jesus is not present, you know what you come off sounding like? Beginners. You know, that's what a lot of people out there in the world, we like to call heathens, or pre-Christians is a much nicer term, I think. All right? Heathens, pagans, whatever you want to call them. People that don't know Jesus yet, non-believers, they look at the church and they see the church is against everything. Why, you know, they don't like drinking and playing cards and dancing and all those good things. And you certainly never want to have premarital sex because that leads to dancing. Ooh. The church is against everything, right? We're the beginners. We're against everything. And yet, you see, our doctrine may be right, but our love is wrong, or at least it's fallen. Who is our first love? It should be Jesus Christ, pure and simple, always. Devotion to Jesus over everything. By the way, in your marriage, what should be the most important thing? How much money you got in your bank account? How many dates you take your wife on every month or year in some cases? Jim, do you even remember your wife's birthday? Yeah, I'm never gonna let you live that one down. Right? What's our devotion level, right? What's our first priority every day when we wake up? When my feet hit the ground and I feel the pain, I am reminded that there is a God who loves me. And my first prayer is, Lord, please help the pain in my feet. I would like to get out of bed one day and not have pain. Still waiting on that prayer to be answered. Some of y'all are in that with me. Just maybe your back or something else. My back is twingy today, so I got to be careful. It likes to throw itself out, and then I lay in the bed for 3 days while I recover from that. So don't want that to happen. But I hold this against you. You've forsaken your first love. And if you don't do that, oh, what was that word? Repent. And oh, by the way, this is in Greek, and it's in the aorist tense. And you know what the aorist tense means? Immediately. If you don't repent now, is the emphasis in Greek. If you don't repent now, then I may come and remove your candlestand or lampstand. You know what? There is no lampstand anymore in Ephesus. There is no church thriving. The church, at some point after this letter was written, shriveled up and died. We don't know the exact day. It's not written in historical documents for us. We don't know when the church ceased to exist or when everybody had to move because the port just became mud. We don't know exactly what happened, but we do know that Ephesus as a town died and Ephesus as a church died and the lampstand was removed. Jesus said, if you don't repent now. You know what? If they had repented, and if their church had still been thriving, you know what? Somebody may have come to them and said, hey, you've got some issues with your port, and y'all need to work on that, because pretty soon it's not going to be there. And that's part of what makes your town thriving and alive. We don't know the answers to all of this, but Jesus did say, if you don't repent, I will come and remove your lampstand. Now remember what the lampstand does. It stands. Even if it's golden, you know what the lampstand does? It just stands there. It stands there with a bowl on top. It is a stand with a bowl. You know what goes in the bowl? Oil. You know what the oil does? It burns. Normally they lay a wick in it and light the wick. And the wick burns from the oil. So the lampstand, we're told, a golden lampstand is the church in Ephesus. But the oil that's in it, which is the light of Christ, is a great reference or symbol of the Holy Spirit. The oil is the thing that's really given the light, not the lampstand. The lampstand is the vessel that Jesus is using for the oil to inhabit so that it can give the light to the rest of the world. And for a church to be the light unto the city and where God puts it, guess what? It needs to maintain its first true love. And if you don't repent, I'll remove the lampstand from its place. And without a lampstand, the church will not survive. There's no place for the Holy Spirit. There's no room for the church to be the light into the community. And then verse 6, but you have this also in your favor. You hate the Nicolaitans and their practices, which I also hate. So up above, you can find six things that they did that were good. Persevering and being steadfast, good sound doctrine, testing evil men and their practices and their false theology. And then you get down, one more. 6 + 1 = 7 is always the answer in the book of Revelation. There's a lot of sevens in the book of Revelation. And then verse 7, he who has an ear. How many ears you got? And I know some of y'all don't work very well, but you have two ears, right? He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches, plural. You see, this letter that's being written is being written to seven individual churches. Up in verse 1, it says to the angel, the messenger of the church, singular, in Ephesus. And then in verse 7, it says, hey, the Spirit says to all of these seven churches, guess what? To him who overcomes. Here's the message for the people in Ephesus. If you overcome, you will be able to eat from the tree of life. Now, does that mean the church or all of the churches or the believers involved in these churches? Yes. The answer is yes. And the answer for us is yes. If we overcome the practice of the Nicolaitans, who were a group of people, we don't know their origin or whatever, but they came out of Hebrew Jewish Christian world and tried to set up another, if you will, church or believing kind of group with bad theology and bad doctrinal practices. And Jesus said, I hate the Nicolaitans. Don't be like them. You know, he talked way much better about others like the Macedonians and how they loved the Lord and how they helped out each other. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches, not just this church, but to all of the churches. And he who overcomes, or she or they, I will give the right to eat of the tree of life, which is in paradise with God. What do we need to learn from this? Well, if we go back to Matthew 6:33, we need to learn this. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then everything else will take care of itself. Amen. That's our number one lesson for the church in Ephesus. Seek first the kingdom of God. Be devoted to the love of Jesus Christ above all else. Because why? When our relationship with the Heavenly Father through his Son Jesus is right, everything else, our marriage, our other relationships, our bank account, our car, everything else in our life will be better. This is not a name it and claim it theology. This is promise in the Word of God. Put perspective and priority where it needs to be. Our first perspective is we're always looking at Jesus because he is the author and perfecter of our faith. He gave us faith. He's perfecting our faith until the day that we become glorified. And that doesn't happen until we're in the presence of God down the road after other things happen. We don't get glorified for a while. But we're right now in the process of sanctification, which means that we are in the process of being made holy. It's a daily thing. Luke 9:23 says, every day I need to take up my cross and follow him. Amen. Daily. Daily I decide. Daily I make my choice. Tuesday I got up and I was going to have a great day. Tuesday I decided to come and do Bible study and we had a great time together opening up the book of Revelation and studying the Word of God. And yet I hold this against you, Don. You have forsaken your first love. Something on Tuesday in my prayer life wasn't right. Something in my love and devotion for Jesus on Tuesday wasn't right. And I allowed the adversary, the wicked one, Satan, the devil, Lucifer, or his minions, to enter into my world. And it consumed me for hours and part of the next day. Why? Well, somewhere my priorities got out of line, or somebody's did anyway. And I reacted instead of responded in truth and love. And so I repented and I sent a lovely email, to which I got a really terse email back from, because he didn't see the two times in there that I apologized for whatever I did. And yet he called me a Pharisee. A Pharisee. Well, I've never been called a Pharisee before. And then I thought, well, there's an attitude in you, Don. What is that? Sounds like a Pharisee, doesn't it? Whatever. So I became one just for him. But, yeah, you know what? Sometimes when you're right in your doctrine, and you know you're right in your doctrine, but you're out of fellowship over here in your love relationship with your Lord, your doctrine may be right, but guess what? You're taken to be a Pharisee instead of a lover of Jesus Christ. And you're right. And yet the world or other pastors still see you as wrong, even though you're right. By the letter of the law, by the doctrine that you hold dear and that, you know, you don't want to abandon and go away from. And yet, over here, should have been more love, should have been more grace, should have been more. And yet, you're right. How could right be wrong? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these other things will come to pass. Do what you did at first is the mandate. Do what you did at first. Go back to when you first loved me and remember how much you loved me at the beginning. I'm going to close with this, and I never say I'm going to close, because in my speech classes for 20 years, I told people never say, and in conclusion, or I'm going to close, because that gives people the idea that you're done. Well, when a pastor says I'm going to close, it means you got 30 more minutes. But no, one more little story. There are these two old gentlemen sitting in the back of the church. And in this church in particular, there were three sets of pews, and the church doors were back behind them. There were other doors way up front, but they're sitting way in the back over here. And a young guy, 20-something young guy, has just gotten saved, and he's on fire for the Lord. And he starts asking the pastor all these questions. And church is over, and these two guys are still just sitting back there talking. And they're watching this young guy, and he's just on fire, and he's so excited, and he wants to do this and this, and can't we do this and do this other and everything. And then one older fellow leans over to the other one and says, hey, give me 6 months. I said, 6 months? What do you need 6 months for? Give me 6 months with that young guy, and he'll be just like us. Now, isn't that sad? Because all they're doing is sitting in the back of church watching people. Oh, and talking about them. And then saying, give me 6 months and he'll be just like us. Is that the direction that young guy needs to go? There's somebody that needs to be there fanning the flame for that kid and saying, hey, let's talk about what you want to do. Let's talk about steps, though. We can't do it all at one time. Here's how we moved forward, and here's resources we already have. How can you plug in? What do we need to do different? Where do you feel like God wants you to go? You know, I've learned that when people walk up to me and say, I believe that God wants you to do a ministry in the nursing home, I look right back at them and say, you know, I believe God wants you to do a ministry in the nursing home. God hadn't laid that on my heart, but evidently he's laid that on your heart. So you need to pray about that. I will support you, and I will pray for you, and maybe occasionally I'll go with you, but that's not a ministry God wants me to have yet. He hadn't laid that on my heart. And I know that usually their intent is to say, Pastor, you need to go and do a ministry at the, you know, nursing home. Not me, but I'm telling you that you need to do that. Well, I actually had somebody tell me that once. And I've learned through these things that, oh, by the way, God may be speaking, but he's not always speaking to you to tell me. He's speaking to you to tell you. And let me be what I'm supposed to be, because you know what I am? I'm supposed to be an equipper. I'm supposed to be an encourager. I'm supposed to help the church do the work of ministry by giving you sound doctrine, but by also telling you that I love you. And more than anything, throw doctrine out the window. I'm going to love you first. And we're going to build a church of people that love each other and are called according to the purposes of God first, so that when people see us and meet us out in the world, they're going to say, why are you weird? And you're going to say, because I love Jesus. Not because I go to this church, not because we have good doctrine, not because I sit on a pew that has my name on it. None of that. You're going to say, I love Jesus. And guess what? He loves me and you. That's why I'm weird. And the Bible tells us to be peculiar people. You know, there's a place in Missouri called Peculiar. Have you ever been there? Don't go. It's pretty normal for being a place called Peculiar. I saw a movie once about a place in Louisiana called Normal, Louisiana. It was not normal. But anyway, so you never know. A name doesn't mean anything. By the way, the name Donald means bold and brave. So Don is half of that. So, yeah, coward chicken, whatever. You understand what God was saying to Ephesus? Right? You've forgotten your first love. Let's go courting again. Let's go back to the days where our love was new and you loved me with a passion and your love for me helped you understand that you needed to do the work of ministry because you love me. And now you're doing the work of ministry because you're good at it and you've forgotten how much you love me. But you're still doing this pretty good, but you need to love me more. Always love Jesus more than anything else. My wife, every once in a while, and I love her for this because it's true and she needs to do this, looks at me every once in a while and says, Don, I love you, but not as much as Jesus. And if you think about it, that's the right response. She loves me. She loves me because only Jesus can help her love me. You got to think about that one too. But anyway, the right response is, I will always love Jesus first, and I will love you next. Because if I don't love Jesus first, my love for you is going to stink, and I'm going to regret it, or you're going to regret it, or we're going to be roommates, or whatever. And you know what? I'm glad she loves Jesus more than she loves me. And she tells that to our daughters. Girls, I love you, but not as much as Jesus. And they laugh. Do the obligatory, oh, mom. And then they understand it's the right order. They know that they're third on her list. Jesus is number one. Most of the time, I'm number two. And they're always number three. But number one and number two are always three. We have two daughters, so number one and number two. They're always number three. She doesn't love one of them any more than the other one. But she always loves me just a little less than Jesus. And that's a good thing, by the way. Lord Jesus, we thank you that your love is abounding and amazing and full. You love us so much that even before you created us, you knew you'd have to come and take our place. You love us so much that one day you went to a cross and hung there and died in agony and pain in human form, so that your divine spirit could be released from your mortal body so that you could go and finish the work that your Father had asked you to do. That's how much you love us. You love us who knew no sin, became sin for us. You bore all of our sin, took our sin away from us and to the cross and died with it so that we could be free. Free from sin, guilt and shame. And we thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you so much for everything you do for us. How much you love us. God, remind us of our first love encounter with you. And show us how far we've fallen. And help us, Lord, to repent and to come back to you. And Father, many of us today need to repent. Let Jesus be the first love again. Put everything aside. Not make any more silver or graved or carved images that look like material possessions or our world or things that take your place. Because that's what Ephesus did. They had a lot of idols to Diana and Artemis. And the church was cutting into that business. Lord, help us not to worry about those things. Help us to focus on you and you alone. And Father, today speak to our hearts. Let the Holy Spirit do a work within us. And help us, God, to remember how much we love you. And that we're called according to your purpose. And we thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name, amen.